Mr. Tay Diggs.
Sir.
Pleasure to meet you. Thanks for coming by USA Today.
Thank you for having me.
Of course, the new Lifetime movie, Terry McMillan Presents Forever. I brought it up on our editorial meeting this morning here at USA Today that you were going to be stopping by. And one of my colleagues immediately was like, remember when Tay followed everyone on X? How great was that? It was Twitter back then. How many people still come up to you and bring that up?
No one.
No one? Okay. No. I'm the first.
But in the moment, it was is what we thought. Well, it was a great way to kind of connect and get more followers or whatever. So
I notice now when I scroll through your social media, kind of, I guess, similar to the way people reacted to that, you are trying to bring some levity into people's lives.
I don't want to be a player no more.
A little bit of light, a little bit of happiness. Is that's the goal here, right?
No, actually, I use it as a means of release. I love that I can just be silly and show people another side of myself that maybe they don't know. And I'm surprised at just how fun it is just to actually create something, finish it and then see it. And then it's always great when you get the positive feedback.
So it does scratch a bit of a creative itch for
you. Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
100%, yeah. As a recovering control freak, it's so great to just have something in my head, do it, and then see it. And then, there's a sense of gratification there.
When you say recovering control freak, is it like was that a therapy thing you worked through?
Or? So I'm still working on it right now. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I want to fix your jacket. No, I'm just kidding.
Please, I can use all the help I can get, Tay.
I'm just joking.
We see in this movie that you do step in as a father figure in a number of different ways, of course, as a coach and then in a more literal term as well. Mm-hmm. How much of your own life are you bringing into this role, at least that aspect of this role?
That was one of the reasons why I was so drawn to this film. It's about adults that have been through life. They've been through divorce. It's adult situations that I 100% can pull from my own life as I'm single, I'm divorced, I have a kid. And you don't see a lot of those stories anymore where, you can see two people meeting each other and, the intricacies and the vulnerabilities that come with that, and just realizing that you can have a second chance at love, and that it's not necessarily all about the arguing and the bickering, but just life circumstances can really add to the dynamics when it comes to new relationships.
In addition to the love story here in this film, your character specifically had a tour overseas. Was an athlete, high school coach. What other, I guess, different facets of this character are you gravitating to the most as you're reading the script and then, going through filming this?
I've been single for a minute, and my co-actress, Megan Goodish, who's amazing. When we were in character, I was like getting to know what it was like to spend time with a female. And I remembered, some of the positive elements that come with, dating and, reintroducing yourself to others' energy and just, creating a friendship again. And I missed that. 'Cause, when you're single, you can get used to kind of being in your own way and on your own way. And you forget what it's like to have to include someone else into your life. So That was something that I was going through while I was filming.
Does life imitate art at all? Does it?
Constantly, yeah. With me, yeah.
Yeah?
Constantly with me, yeah. In a good way. I always use that as a sign that I'm on the right track. Because when I was doing All American, it was when I was becoming really close with my son, and he's an athlete as well, so a lot of the things that we would talk about on that program, me and my son would talk about in real life.
What's unique about making a movie for Lifetime compared to other movies and films that you've been a part of?
Well, this one, I think I've gone the furthest emotionally. And when you talk about life imitating art and vice versa, this one rang the most true just because I'm right smack dab in the middle of all this myself. You know what I mean? When it comes to dating, you don't know who this person is. You're just going off of a vibe, and you don't know how soon you should allow them in and how vulnerable you want to make yourself and when. So all of this was happening, and I think it makes the performances even more rich.
Have you been able to get out and date and maybe step out of your comfort zone a little bit or no?
Yeah. I had to force myself. I had to make a decision, I'm gonna date now. And even that, when you're younger, it's kind of fun and it's exciting. Now you're what are we gonna talk about? We're gonna talk about parents and where you're coming from, how long you've been acting. So I gotta really pump myself up to put myself out there. But I've gone on a couple of dates and it's been fun.
You mentioned your son Walker is an athlete. Is he being recruited by anyone yet? Basketball is his main sport, right?
In my head, yeah. people are coming to these little schools and asking about him. But now it's about he's at that age where he could really make some strides. So we're reclassing him and a lot of football, a lot of basketball, private coaching and strength training and he shoves me around the house . He's always shoving me, proving to me that he's strong. He's strong. But every once in a while, I just got to put him in his place and make sure he knows I'm the top dog.
When you stepped on set, the first thing I noticed was you were wearing orange. I'm, of course, a fellow Syracuse alumnus. You were at school the same time Adrian Autry, the current head coach, is there. I guess you didn't cross paths with him, right, Ben?
No. Yeah, we were VP. I was doing dance classes and putting on leg warmers, but... But I do remember, who was there? Lawrence Moten was there.
Sherman Douglas there, maybe? Or no, that might have been a little before you. Him and DC might have been
DC,
before you.
Yes.
DC was there.
Yep.
DC was
yep.
there.
Okay. Eric Coleman, definitely. Yeah, he was the big to-do. Mm-hmm. But, I had a really great time there.
Do you get back at all?
I do. Well, I just went back there for, what was it? Something. But, I'm in close contact with them. Yeah, those are some formative years.
Your upbringing's interesting. Born in Newark, relocated mm-hmm. to Rochester, and then of course you end up at Syracuse. Mm-hmm. What do you remember about growing up in Rochester? That had to be interesting for you.
It was perfect. It was just big enough where we could get into a small amount of trouble, but not big enough where the trouble really mattered. You know what I mean? It was great. The winters were wonderful. Sledding and, during the warm seasons, we had all these festivals. And, I had a big family, so it was a great place to grow up. Great place to leave, but also a great place to grow up.
And, of course, now here we are, this studio is right in Broadway, right in Times Square, surrounded by Broadway. When you come back to this particular neighborhood, what memories immediately flood back?
Oh, man, walking to auditions and in New York. Growing up in Rochester, New York was always a place I set my sights. So once I got here, it just made living here, all that much more exciting and, feeling like I was actually accomplishing something. And I still get that feeling when I come back, just, seeing all the buildings and all of the people on the street, people are just so... Everybody feels so driven here, It's a little different in LA when everyone's in their cars. You don't make that connection, but you can just, you can feel the energy of everyone around you. We're all getting something done, even if it's just walking around the block. I like that, and I miss it.
That's what I was going to ask if you missed it.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, I'm going to get back here.
Are you... full LA Olympic mode now? Is that inescapable out west with 2028?
It's a lot.
Around the
it's
corner?
A lot. It's always great because there's always something to watch on TV. It's really easy to just whether you're at the gym or at the grocery store, look up and vote for that flag. But it's fun. It's fun. That in itself, even in LA, is a way where people can come together and kind of bond over that. So it was cool.
What do you got going on for the rest of the year?
Oh, I'm really excited to come out with this this show, performance show. Me, Martina McBride, Heidi Gardner, Emmanuel Atso. We're judging this show where performers have a second chance at recovering their dream. So that was very emotional. I'm very excited for that.
Those types of shows are interesting. There's a lot of great stories, of course, within the various contestants. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's a competition, right?
100%.
So how do you kind of thread that needle between, you know, you can't give everyone a performance medal or, you know, a participation medal, rather, I should say. But, you know, also you want to respect people's stories. How difficult is that, being a judge on those stories?
It was difficult. It was difficult. And at first I didn't think that the story would lend itself to our decision making, but once you hear these stories, it definitely, you know, makes you look at the type of performances that they took part in, and you know what these people had to go through and overcome. That was huge. It was very emotional and difficult but fun. But it's wonderful to recognize the courage that people still have. When getting up on that stage and doing what they love, regardless of what they've been through.
Nice to hear that you kind of embraced the human aspect of it and didn't just shut it off and say, okay, nope, you were good, you weren't good.
Yeah.
Hello, goodbye.
I tried, but it was impossible. It was impossible. And in life, I think sometimes we need to be reminded that we're all human beings and we're all going through our own situations, and to just let that impact how we treat each other.
The movie Again Forever, when it premieres on Lifetime and then it streams, what do you hope people feel from it?
I hope people are moved. You know, that's why we do what we do. But then the thread of the movie for me is, you know, don't be afraid to take second chances. You know what I mean? Regardless of how hurt you've been, you know, try to stay out there and keep continue to be open.
Mr. Tay Diggs,
sir.
Appreciate you stopping by. Thanks so much, and congratulations on the film.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.